All right, very great. Here we go again, trying to get the most information possible out to you in the timely manner, talking about things that you probably won't hear many other places. It's pretty difficult to do this. It should be easy, should be a piece of cake for me, but it's not, because the resistance is so extreme. We talked about the resistance. What is the resistance again? Death is a defense against annihilation. Think of it this way. Reality is all one. It's not pieces stitched together. No seams. It's all just like one diamond, let's say. Now, what if the diamond said, I want to not be a diamond? Okay. Well, what's that? What idea is that really? It's really saying annihilation. I want to be annihilated. When spirit wants to become prime creator, it's really talking about its own annihilation, because it is one with the prime creator. It is one with all reality. It is all one. Not a unity, but a oneness from the very beginning. So any idea of changing this perfect, seamless oneness is the idea of annihilation. So when spirit had this idea of wanting to be prime creator, it was really desiring its own annihilation. And so immediately it defended against this annihilation. How did it defend against it? By this hypothetical scenario of death, of limiting loss, of loss being partial. Okay. Partial loss. So it's an imaginary, hypothetical situation, because there's reality is all that there is, and it's all one, and it can never suffer loss. But so we needed to imagine, to dream up that there was some situation that where loss was limited, and then we identify ourselves as living there, that's where life is, and that yes, life is suffering death and loss, but it's not a total loss, because there's other life being born. So it's, you have a cycles of births and deaths, and birth and death, and in between, ergo, you have the existence. What we are identifying with here. So when you talk about freedom from death, from existence, from this ridiculous charade, this parade of birth and death, it's automatically assumed you're talking about annihilation. You're taking away the defense against annihilation, which is terrifying, and people can't stand it. They want to talk about anything other than that. So what happens is you talk about all these side trips, and you never get to the nitty gritty. That's the problem. That's the problem here. We can talk about spiritual topics endlessly and never touch upon the nitty-gritty important stuff at all. And people live lives that way. And they're so relieved when they die. Say, oh, I made it. I finally made it again. I have managed to avoid annihilation. You have to laugh. You have to laugh at it. It's so silly, but it's what takes place here. So it's super difficult to talk about this stuff here. That's why you don't hear it talked about. It's not because it's not true. It's because it's so difficult. It's so stressful. Because you have to buck the collective will of the universe to not focus on this. It's deemed as way too dangerous to focus on. The kind of information we look at here is deemed way, way too dangerous. It's taboo, the taboo of all taboos. Do not look here, because behind this door they think is annihilation. If you start recognizing that we've made all this, it's all just a hypothetical scenario, death. People say, no, it's real, God created it, it's real. They're so desperate to make it real, they insist that God created all this, death, permanence. So then they can say, well, see, we can never lose it. You see, so we'll always have it. It means we'll always be protected from annihilation by believing that impermanence is God created and is therefore eternal and never ending. And they, you know, there's a refusal to see that we're simply making it up. We're making it up and sustaining that make-believe. You know, when you make-believe something, you just sustain it through your own imagination. until finally you say, ah, okay, I'm tired of that. And then you stop sustaining the make-believe. It's like somebody pretending to be dead. You know, they just go, ah, I'm dead. And then they say, ah, I'm tired of this. Okay, I'm not dead anymore. Like that. That's it. But again, behind people are terrified that without this defense of death, of partial loss, that it would result in their annihilation. There'd be no defense against the idea of wanting to change reality, which would be annihilation. If they don't realize, they can simply exchange ideas. Nobody has to hold on to this idea of wanting to be prime creator. You can just decide, well, we don't want to be prime creator, so we don't. There's no fear of annihilation. No need to then have, you know, this scenario of birth and death and everything in between. So it's really simple, very easy, and yet it is incredibly difficult to push against that resistance in the world. So it's a very shameful thing for me to have so much trouble. You know, it should be just like that piece of cake. Should have done it, you know, long, long ago, which I did, but I got the pushback, you know, the backlash. So you get that incredible backlash by those who are super, you know, loyal to death, and death is everything to them. And of course, obviously, when we talk about something dying, we look at the obituaries, we say, oh, someone died. Who died? Someone died. In other words, someone was here first. Something we call living, some person was here. How'd they get here? They were born. So death requires birth. Death requires birth. Requires being born. It requires something growing. It requires something here that can then die. You can't have nothing die. Although all this stuff in existence is really nothing. It's just hypothetical. What if all this were possible? But it's not possible. So death, there's cycles. Death and birth is this continuous cycle as we desperately try to calm down our fears of annihilation. Not understanding where it's coming from. We keep being frustrated, like, oh, that's still there, it's still there, it's still there, because we don't realize it comes from our desire to be prime creator. We took up the idea of, what if we were prime creator? You know, hypothetical, what if we were prime creator? Well, you'd have to change reality, right? And reality can't be changed. So the desire to change reality is really the desire to annihilate reality. And since we are our reality, is a desire to annihilate ourselves. And so we live in this dread of our own desire to be annihilated, and try to siphon it off, as it were, by constant cycles of birth and death, birth and death, birth and death, hoping we can somehow get rid of this inner urge to be annihilated. We think it's something, we can't remember where it came from. It's a mystery. It's no mystery. There's no mystery at all. But the fear of it all turns everything into a big mystery. There is no mystery to truth whatsoever. It's a piece of cake. It's simple as simple can be. But our dread of annihilation causes us to bifurcate it in endless ways, so that it seems so incredibly difficult and mysterious, and we can't figure it out. We pretend to like to try and figure it out, but inside we're so relieved that we can't figure it out. We say, oh boy, aren't we lucky that we can't quite get it. So what you have on the spiritual path is a lot of grinding, a lot of difficulty. Yeah, I'm trying to get it, but never quite get it. And inside we're saying, oh gosh, I'm so glad I didn't get it, you know, because I'll be annihilated if I get it. There, that's the difficulty in a nutshell. If you want it in a nutshell, that's it. And it's a weird thing. The truth is so simple, so obvious, and yet the world seems to have such an incredibly difficult time with it. And now you know why. Now you know why. So that should relieve a lot of frustration you have towards everyone else. Like, and you're thinking, how come I can't get it, and I can't explain it, and you know, because the world has this, you know, absolute paranoia, this phobia, truthophobic problem. have this, the ultimate phobia is the phobia about simply knowing the truth, realizing the truth. We don't realize that we cannot change reality. We have no power, authority, ability whatsoever to change reality, to annihilate reality. We cannot do it, so we don't need to worry about annihilation. It's not possible. So we don't need this whole death-based nonsense, this parade of birth and death. All these things, seeing things as that which marches to death by seeing time, what's called time. Time, it doesn't exist, actually. It's made up. We're making it up because each moment is free and clear of every other moment. And yet we make up this narrative that everything is aging, is changing, and is going towards death. It's not really like that at all. Because each moment, everything in that moment is totally present and alive to that particular moment. And moments are not linked together like a chain. They are not. But we can sequence moments and then imagine that they're linked together in a chain, which then we imagine that there's something that's actually dying. There's something that's actually alive, is really the whole gist of it, is we're pretending that there's something actually alive in existence. There's nothing alive in existence. Everything is alive to each moment, but it's not alive across moments, as it were, in time. There's nothing, no life in time whatsoever, none. There's no death there either. But the illusion of life and death appear in our, and when we imagine there's such a time, meaning moments are linked together like a chain. Like one moment somehow is causing the next moment to be what it is. That's not true. It's our imagination is sustaining each moment. But they're not linked. It's not that the previous moment is causing the next moment independent of our imagination. No. Our imagination is simply sequencing each moment to give the appearance, that the illusion, that there's some life there and therefore a death can take place. It's not, and each moment, it's not like there are things so much. It's that there's just this oneness, a one thing, as it were. Or you might say everything is a thing in itself unto that moment, but in total relation with everything else in that moment too. It's beyond our capacity to imagine it. We can experience it, but we can't quite describe the clarity of that. But we can get a general idea, actually, general idea of timelessness. But with timelessness, there's no life, or there's no death in hypotheticals, in dreams, in things, in this. There is, you might say, again, a perfect aliveness, a perfect presence to that moment, that timeless moment. But there is no presence in relationship to what we call life and death. There is no relationship presence to that whatsoever. It's not there. And so when people sometimes have a glimpse of a moment of timelessness, they say, wait, where's the death? You know, where it disappeared. The universe of life and death disappeared. It's gone. I can't find it. And then it panics them. And they say, I need that, or else I'm going to be annihilated. So this is the type of topic that needs to be brought to light, and you have to realize you're capable of looking at this, and it's no big deal. You're able to look at it. You say, okay, yeah, I can see that. And timelessness is already the case, actually. It's always already the case, timelessness. There's no such thing as time. We're just... we're decreeing that it's there because we want it to be there. We want death to be there. So we are simply arrogating that it's there. We're simply making a decree. It is there. There is such a thing as time. but there is not. There is not. So I would say, I guess the shock would come when you give up the arrogance of saying that there's time there and realizing there is no time. That would come up as a shock to those who have not prepared for it. And it would seem like a mystical experience that one would, you know, then it would fade back into a belief in time at some point, probably. And then one would say, well, I had a mystical experience of God or something like that. But well, it doesn't have to fade away, because it can be permanent, actually. The great teachers are permanently in this timeless condition, which is a condition where all of us are already in that condition, actually. We're just arrogating the notion, the belief that there's such a thing as time. There's not. So we're already there. It's just that we're trying to insist that we're not there. You think that there is an I, okay. There is a self. There is an I. It's just not in time, because there is no time. It's not there. You can't find it in time. It's not there. But there is an I. Of course, there is a self. We are each, all aspects of spirit, facets of one diamond. It's just that there's no I in time, because there is no time. The I is the timeless I. The eyes that look out upon time are looking upon nothing. They're not even eyes at all. At least hearing this, you can say, okay, there's something there to get. I can feel it. There's something there to get. The world right now is obsessed with not getting this. Obsessed with not getting this. Obsessed with death, with keeping death viable. How does the world do that? It focuses so much on death, trying to manage it. See, what we call the fourth dimensionals are trying to be in control of death. They say, yes, there's death, but we're in control of it, so we can control, it's managed. It's all managed. We grow all the crops here, and we manage all the crops, the plants, the people, everything's like a managed crop. So we grow crops of death, and it's all completely micromanaged, and we know, so we're in control, and we're doling it out. Exactly the way we want it to. Whereas like those in 3D, it's death seems to be in charge of them instead of them in charge of death, where death keeps feel like either good luck or bad luck or destiny or fate, and somehow the death gets you or doesn't get you. And that's how the experience of 3D is, that you sometimes it gets you and sometimes it does not. Sometimes, you know, people say, well, death has its own ways about it and there's nothing we can do about it. Whereas 4D, it says, no, we're the ones who are bringing the death upon everything in a very controlled, structured way. But both the same. They're both belief in time, both belief in death, both as a defense against annihilation. It's exactly the same basic situation. It's just two different ways of going about it. So this world right now is frantically struggling to keep death going. And there's disagreements between the third and fourth dimensionals on how to do that. The planet has basically been taken over by fourth dimensionals, by a grossly ignorant, you know, mindset, actually. And they are imposing their mode of death upon the planet, the structured and engineered death, as it were. Again, knowing that death is an assembly line that starts with birth. Okay, so maintenance of that form, that is to die. It's all sacrificial. The universe is sacrificial. Everything is formed so that it can then die. Everything is an assembly line. And of course, we, to make it palatable, we sugarcoat it and call the part in between the birth and the death, we call it life. And we call it something to be enjoyed. How can you enjoy it when you can see that everything is simply on an assembly line, a conveyor belt, going to death, to destruction? But what's to enjoy? There's nothing really here at all. It's just all these forms of death waiting to go into the oven. It's not enjoyable. That's not enjoyable. That's not something that we enjoy. That's not something our mind enjoys. We were created by the prime creator to enjoy life, which is eternal. There's no death at all. So it's a charade. All this stuff about how wonderful existence is, it's just bravado. It's just a way of sugarcoating so that you don't start grumbling too much and say, hey, I don't like this. And then you start feeling the dread of annihilation when you do that. When you start to peck away at the defense system of the universe that the mind is employing to try to minimize the dread of annihilation, when you start to peck away at it, you start to fear this dread of annihilation, which really is very severe, very terrible feeling. Terrible anxiety, free-floating anxiety. Because annihilation doesn't have any limit to it, does it? So you can't pin it on anything. So it's called free-floating anxiety. Really, completely free-floating anxiety doesn't come from anywhere. He says, where is it? Is it the loss of this I'm worried about? The loss of my death? Someone else's death? Suffering? No, it doesn't come from any of those. It comes from the fear of annihilation of everything. Nothing left at all. Complete vanishing of all that is. That's where it comes from. So it's very severe and it's completely free-floating and you cannot pin it down, which is a very frustrating situation because you think, if I could just figure out what it is I'm afraid of losing, then I could at least deal with that, and you can't do it. You cannot do it. So that's what I discovered. I discovered all of this just through living through it. And now knowing this is what it is. So, of course, my focus is on to speed up things as much as possible, to give clarity on all this so that people don't suffer so much, because all of us have to exchange hypotheticals and say, what if reality could not be annihilated? What if we couldn't change reality? What if reality was unchangeable? And that solves a continuity issue for us. So we all have to do that. So we all have to face this free-floating anxiety. In my case, I have had to figure it out myself for some reason and get a little, you know, some help here and there along the way, but had to get it, figure it out, what's really going on. But it shouldn't be so difficult. I'm a little surprised that someone just didn't spell it out like this. It's because it should be obvious. He's a cake. But it's almost like there's such a continuity issue. We have such a fear of continuity, lack of continuity, and there's such bifurcation of all the different defenses of talking about all everything else, that when we try to approach the spiritual path, we assume that some of this stuff in the world must be it, and therefore whatever we hear, whatever teaching we get, must align, have some continuity with all this other teaching. And yet the other teaching, all this other stuff, doesn't deal with this central fact at all. So you want continuity with something which doesn't deal with the central fact in order to feel some relief, sense of your continuity still there. So it causes you to wander. And that's the trouble. That's what takes so long. It's frustrating because you know the answer's there. You just, why is it taking so long? Because you want to have a sense of continuity with what's come before and what other teaching is saying. So you're unwilling to get out there on a limb, as it were. Then when you get there, you say, what took so long? It's so easy. It's ridiculous. How could it possibly have taken me so long? That's the trouble. So the patience is required is ridiculous, because it's a situation like you know that the answer's there, but for some reason you're taking the long way around. And it is, oh boy, do I really have to keep taking the long way around? My gosh, the scenic route, as it were. So it's not necessary, but the fear of a loss of continuity, which is again also part of our dread, that if we set down this attempt to change reality, we'll suddenly be catapulted back into awareness of reality, and it'll be so different than what we're used to that will freak us out. We're worried about that, very worried. So we insist on continuity, and on the spiritual path we assume that most of the teaching must be in the world must be accurate, so we not want to be have align with that first. But in aligning with that, what happens? We get aligning with all these side trips, and then it ends up taking us, you know, for so long struggling through all these side trips, trying to figure out, you know, how come I can't get it? How come I can't get it? What's wrong with me? What's wrong with me? Very unfortunate. It would be better, you would think it would be better to start out with in a situation where there's very little spiritual teaching at all. And then just start right with the basics. On this planet, there's so many spiritual teachings. Good grief, like an ocean, vast swamp of these various side trips. And so very, very little of just direct teaching. Of the very basics, the easy stuff, the simple truth. So very little. Because people won't pay attention. They won't pay attention. Because they say, no, it's got to be more complicated. Because I see everything else is so complicated. This has to be complicated. Otherwise, I feel very threatened. The complexity implies choice, options. In reality, what complexity is there? It's nothing but simplicity. There's no options to choose among in reality, other than you're experiencing ideas. But as far as options of truth, there's no options. Everything is true. The options that we're used to, there's nothing like that at all. So it's completely simple. It's not like there's light and dark. It's only light. It's not like there's truth and lies. There's only truth. So it's not like you're trying to choose between truth and lies. No, no choice. No choices are necessary in reality like that. So it's the opposite of complex. Okay. So, and whereas existence is extremely complex, and we, of course, annihilation, it would be very simple too, wouldn't it? So we try to worship complexity. So any spiritual teaching that's simple, it scares us. And we say, well, we don't want that. It can't be true. It's too threatening to us, because it's too close to reality, the perfect simplicity of reality. So there are all these underlying factors that slow us down and trip us up and are just so aggravating, because we know we're capable of it, and yet it seems to take so long. It's just ridiculous. And that's everybody experienced that, which is why the great sages tell us those who persevere to the end will be saved, meaning those who continue on in spite of how long it seems to be taking are the ones that finally succeed. I think Yogananda said a saint is a sinner that never gave up, never gave on the path, which is true. It's frustrating. You know it's on the tip of your tongue. Truth is always on the tip of your tongue. Except you can never quite spit it out, it seems like. And even when you get it, you tend to forget it. That too. But one needs to be matter-of-fact about it with some humor. That's the best way. Just be matter-of-fact with some humor, and just repeat it and go over it. keep reinforcing it. Matter of fact, no mystery to it. Sense of humor, acknowledging how silly it is that it seems to be this difficult, and how really silly, simplistic, and easy it all is, and we're pretending it's so difficult. That's kind of funny. And then reinforcement, just to keep reminding ourselves that it is this simple and easy, and to stop chasing after rainbows of complexity that seems to offer us, a defense against annihilation. It's like we want to use duality as a defense against annihilation, saying, well, we're not sure if it's this or that, and like confusion. Oh, here comes my annihilation, but I'm confused. Is it the annihilation or is it not? I can't tell. So that we feel that protects us. It's like ostrich sticking their head in the sand. So we cultivate confusion, lack of clarity, all this stuff to as defenses that we feel are protecting us from that terrible, terrible, dreadful day of judgment where annihilation will come upon us. But of course, it never will. There is no such thing. We cannot annihilate reality. We can't change reality. Reality is all there is, so there's no annihilation. There's none. Never will be. Now the cat keeps relocating. As the sun moves, the cat gets up and relocates to stay with the sun. And I've often spoke of relocation where the shadows hit this planet. They're hitting this planet. The it's a very, very dark and disempowered time on this planet as the fourth dimensionals take over the planet and have basically induced the third dimensionals to give up their austere dedication and humility, and to just indulge in very, very arrogant pursuits, as it were. The third dimensionals on this planet have become very badly contaminated. And of course, the fourth dimensionals are just, on an extraordinary ego trip. So right now you have a combination of fourth dimensionals on this planet, along with contaminated third dimensionals who've given up their task and responsibility in the third dimension, which is to choose once again whether you want the fourth or the fifth dimension. That's what the third dimension is for. It's kind of like a step backwards, or sidestepping, and then we say, okay, and I don't really want the fourth, but do I want the fifth? And then to finally come to a decision on that. The fifth is where we see the big picture, and then that leads directly to the death-free realms beyond the fifth dimension. So in the third dimension, one is supposed to be very strict in the life, very humble, very simple, and everyone's supposed to reinforce for everyone else to keep up the perseverance. So it's like a community. It's like a collective endeavor of humility and people watching out for others. And if someone else starts to go awry, they quickly reprimanded and kindly reprimanded. And that is what it's supposed to be. That is what it's supposed to be. So third dimension is supposed to be religious. It's supposed to be a religious place. That's what religion is. It's simply the community of those who are taking on the responsibility of austerity, simplicity, humility, and reinforcing that in others. That's what it is, so that people can feel comfortable in accepting the extremely simple truth of the whole situation. There's no complexity to it. So you're not ostracized for turning your mind in the direction of simplicity. It's very important. But humility is not an end in itself. And 3D, don't fall in love with 3D. Don't fall in love with this world at all. It's temporary. It's temporary. It's impermanent. That's another problem 3Ds have. They get seduced into trying to fall in love and worship the world. That's not what it's for. What it's for is this. So 3D is supposed to be religious. Okay. 4D is profoundly non-religious. Religion is banned there in 4D. The religion is productivity and distribution and maximizing, being in control of death, producing as much death as possible, streamlining it all. So feeling like you always can be able to produce as much death as you need to calm your fears. And so, no real religion in 4D at all. That's why those who come from 4D to this planet, they hate religion here. You know, they despise it. They condemn it. They demonize it. They attack the leaders of religion and the icons, religious icons, and they say they're terrible. And they have this virulent dislike. Causes great fear in them because it's headed towards simplicity, away from the arrogance of the fourth dimension. And so they want to get rid of religion here on this planet, no question about it. If you want to know what the agenda is, well, is it's to conform this planet to fourth dimensional standards. And one of those, all important, is to wipe out religion. Now, of course, they'll replace it with what they say is a one-world religion, but it's it'll just be some pablum, you know, baby food. A temporary feel-good thing to assuage the third dimensional, saying, don't worry, we got this one-world religion for you. So, but no, fourth dimensionals don't want any limit on their capacity to control and direct death. And they want as much sophistication and complexity as possible, which again defends against simplicity. And the truth is very simple. The simple realization that we're simply making all this up terrifies them. They say, no, all this is real, but we are able to be on control of it, manipulate it, etc. That's fourth dimensional. Where what happens is the fourth dimensionals come to the third dimension to rehabilitate and simplify and be able to accept the simple truths that are necessary that go to the fifth dimension. But when too many fourth dimensionals come into the world and overwhelm it, then they bring too much of that fourth dimension with them, and they don't get properly streamlined into religions here. And then they become, their arrogance just gets out of control, and they eventually end up taking over the planet, which is what has happened here on planet Earth. They're essentially in control of the future here. That's how they've set it up, very, very clever. So they're here to mass produce death and have it very streamlined and efficient. Of course, that's what the Nazis were all about. That was like a precursor to what's coming up. Is they wanted to create the super race, super death. Let's create super death. Streamline it all. Get rid of all the bad genetics. Let's have everything, birth and all, everything very, very streamlined and engineered and exactly the way we want it. And anything that doesn't fit in, let's just get rid of it entirely. That's fourth dimensional attitude, absolutely. And so that is the situation with the world now. So you might say the world is in a very, very bad place. Nothing's happening here, essentially. It's stagnated. Severe stagnation. Because third dimensionals have been so corrupted now by the fourth dimensionals. The fourth dimensionals bring all this technology with them. Radio, photographs, television, computers, smartphones, on and on, all this stuff. That all comes from fourth dimensionals. And they bring that in, and they set up movie theaters and television sets, etc., for the third dimensional, saying, hey, why are you struggling with such a hard scrabble, unhappy life? Why don't you have fun? Why don't you party? Look at these movies. Go have fun. Go to the movie theater. Enjoy yourself. Have some popcorn. Enjoy yourself. And afterwards, go to a bar and have something to drink and live it up. So they contaminate third dimensionals, who are supposed to be doing the opposite of that, which is trying to live austere and humble a life as possible, so that they feel very conformed to simple truth, because truth is simple. Period. Very, very simple and very direct and very unambiguous and very non-complex and very non-sophisticated. You see, so for the sake of continuity, we need to have a lifestyle that fits the content of our mind. At least we feel that continuity is very important that way. We have to basically expect it based on our lifestyle. So religions are super important. Religions are just a set of strictures, of rules and regulations of how to live a very humble lifestyle. That's what it is. How best to get a sense of continuity with the truth, a lifestyle that sort of lends itself towards entertaining the truth. So it's essential that there are these religious strictures, and people here on third dimension spend their time in some sort of, you know, spiritual discipline, religious discipline, and hopefully get help from others to keep them on the straight and narrow path. And when they start backsliding, someone says, speaks up, you know, and corrects them, reprimands them. And what I've found in this world, one of the most amazing things of the last 50 years, is the change in people's willingness to speak up and correct one another, either in the family or in public. Everyone, I was terrified to do that. I don't see it anywhere. And so many times I want to speak up, and I feel this huge dread, like I'm going to get in severe trouble if I do. You know, that is a fourth dimensional thing. In the fourth dimension, they call it tolerance. You're not supposed to criticize anyone for anything. They feel very, quote-unquote, uncomfortable with being reprimanded at all. You see? So, of course, and with that, it's easy for people to backslide and go astray, and nobody will say a word to them. Absolutely counterproductive to the ultimate extent. When I was young, of course, adults had every right to reprimand children and themselves, etc. Nobody thought twice about, you know, their grandmother said, hey, you know, we don't do that here, or, you know, and really, you get severe reprimands that let you know that, you know, you have to live in a certain humble way here, and no fooling around here, okay? And that now it's like the parents and grandparents are living in legal dread of the children making complaints about them. Like, well, my parents are too strict. Oh, well, let's jail your parents then, or send them to counseling, or, you know, something like that. It's completely upside down at this point. And as far as reprimanding strangers, you know, that's so taboo. I cannot tell you an instance of that I can even remember, of out in public, you know, saying, I mean, my dad used to reprimand smokers all the time. And back then there was no smoking sections in restaurants or wherever you go in public. Everyone just lit up and smoked, and he hated it, and he'd say, hey, you know, and he'd speak up and reprimand them now. You know, and now, like, if you see someone smoking, everyone's afraid to, you know, kind of say anything. Most people are. There's still a few people that will, but that's just an easy case. But in subtler situations, you know, you see crazy drivers. Oh my gosh, I want to, you know, I honk the horn sometimes. Say, let them know they're driving in a very inappropriate manner. There are some people on the road now that the driving is so atrocious, it's incredible. Good Lord, I saw one a couple days ago. It was in a Prius of all cars, just absolutely weaving through traffic. It was on a very, I think it was on a very dangerous road, actually. Crazy, crazy stuff. Cutting in and getting, driving up on people and then cutting over with tolerances like that were like a foot or two at high speeds. It was absolutely lunatic, endangering everybody's lives, you know. And it just, like, I wanted to, it happened so fast I didn't have a chance. But you want to honk the horn, you know, get their attention. But that is, it's just not done. Nobody does anything for fear of legal consequences. So the entire situation on this planet has been rigged through the legal system to favor the fourth dimensional agenda here. So we think that, well, maybe things will work out. No, they won't. No, they will not. The legal system has been booby-trapped entirely. Entirely booby-trapped to completely favor the fourth dimensional agenda on this planet. So it is a time of utmost darkness. It is the darkest time of the Kali Yuga, the Dark Ages. So it is literally now we're in the Dark Ages. The Dark Ages weren't the Middle Ages, not at all. These ages we're in right now are the Dark Ages, the darkest of the Dark Ages, and it's not going to get any better. It's going to collapse. The fourth dimensionals will get things, you know, their way for sure. So, which is why I say the cat simply when the sun is moves and some branches casting shade, the cat just kind of shuffles over and sits down where the sun is. It relocates. So it's cat smart. The cat doesn't say, "Oh, I better not do this." You know, the thought police are gonna, people are wondering, weird. No. The cat just says, "Hey, this is where it's warm. This is where I'm gonna go." Simple. And we have so much strictures against this now. The fourth dimension is saying, no, there's no place beyond the fourth dimension. There's no other place else to go. We are it. You know, the fourth dimensionals keep telling the planet that they are it. And they bring their silly little glass beads of gadgets with them, as if somehow this is supposed to entrance us, you know. And telling us that this is it. This is it. Which is quite humorous, actually, if you knew how silly it was. The effrontery is funny if you're not, you know, fooled by it. See, braggadocio and all that kind of stuff, if you know what it is, then you have a good laugh with it. But if you don't, then it seems very, very serious stuff. Oh my gosh, this is it, huh? So, we can certainly relocate. We just are not getting permission from the fourth dimensionals to do it. You see, we don't need their permission. You know, if we believe that they are it, then we assume, well, we got to get their permission. No, they're not remotely it. They're about as far away from it as one can get. They're in need of therapy, the therapy of third dimensional therapy. That's what they're in need of. So, this planet third dimensionally has been compromised to an unbelievable extent. So it's necessary to have another third dimensional scenario working. It's necessary to set up religions there, which is sets of discipline. It's discipline, leading a disciplined life, a simple, humble, unpretentious, disciplined life, which enables one to consider the simple truth, and then ascend to the fifth dimension, and from there to the death-free realms, and from there to set down all hypotheticals altogether and enjoy the eternal riches of reality. So it's kind of like a rehabilitation step, the third dimension, and it's something that we have to go through. So we need to set up the rehabilitation center of the third dimension in a viable way that's not being contaminated by fourth dimensionals. You see, this planet had a protection around it, as it were. Kind of a resonance of will, of third-dimensional responsibility. That was broken down. August 18th, 1999 is when the dimensional barriers were completely breached here. And the fourth dimensional was able to bring their full momentum of their agenda into this planet. Was that August 18th, 1999? I experienced that. It was that was really... You might say the end of this age happened at that time, kicked off the end times period. And the fourth dimensionals are bringing their icons, their idols to this planet, their idols who they're so severe and so cruel as far as insisting that they continue their relentless pursuit of controlling death so that they produce unlimited and qualities of exactly what death they want to produce and how much of it in all given circumstances and how to distribute it exactly and all this kind of stuff. Meaning things, consumerism, secular humanism, all this stuff, fourth dimensional stuff. And of course they're busy demonizing all the third dimensionals and their silly superstitions about trying to follow certain religious strictures, etc., etc., which is what they love to demonize the third dimensional. So it's not good for the third dimensionals, this place. Not good right now. Not good at all. Not good at all. The escape velocity is not present in third dimensional considerations on this planet at this time. Their disciplines are very weak. Very weak. Very tepid. Very feeble. Very feeble. You have to be very much. Third dimensionals need to be very brisk and dedicated to their disciplines, and go for it. Really, you cannot just have this lukewarmness, which is what's going on the planet. anything other than severe lukewarmness is demonized entirely now. So the effectiveness of third dimension, I see, has come to an end. It's come to an end. So that needs to be transferred onto some other planet, third dimensional planet, and continued on there. Now, those who have already used third dimensional appropriately go shift to the fifth dimension. The fifth dimension. And from there, the fifth dimension is where teachers come for third dimension. They also come from occasionally from the death-free realms, the super teachers. And so there will be this big reorganization taking place, basically. The fifth take care of the third. Essentially, that's the relationship. And the fourth keep trying to interfere in this. So it's like the fifth are the good shepherds for the third, teaching them how to use time correctly, right use of time, right use of mind in the third dimensional situation to free themselves from the fourth dimensional obsession and familiarity with complexity so that they can grasp the simple truth of the entire situation. Complexity cannot grasp it. You cannot grasp it. It's not complex. It's impossible to make it complex. Truth is entirely simple, actually. It's beyond any grasping of the mind at all, ultimately. But we can symbolize it in a way that is has at least a little bit to it, so the mind can grasp it, as it were, get familiar with it. So it's a time now of parting of the ways, parting of the destiny paths. Fourth dimensionals will have their way with this planet. It's important, again, that you don't get attached to a third dimensional planet, so you don't get into some pitched battle with the fourth dimensionals, thinking that you need to protect your homeland or something. No, there's nothing nice about the third dimension, really. I mean, they say don't make it into something it's not. It's austere. You know, it's not something, not an end in itself. It's not something you want to stay in forever. No way. No way. No, it's no fun. But it's a great rehabilitation place. So with that, there's respect, but not attachment. So the fact that the fourth dimensionals are going to take over the planet, well, you know, knock yourselves out. It's okay. Let them do. They're going to remodel it, is what they're going to do. That's their aim. So they want to wipe out the third dimension. They hate it. They hate it because it scares them. It they feel it threatens their defense system. They want the entire situation to be very sophisticated and complex and endlessly complex and have endless vistas of more and more sophistication and learning, so they feel like they never have to ever put death down, and they're terrified of simplicity. So they look at the third dimension with great fear and dislike, and they want to change it into fourth dimensional situation, which is what they will do with this planet. So don't think you need to stay on this planet and defend it and as if it was your home, and don't have regrets to the planet. This is all just imaginary anyway. It's all just a dream. Again, there is no time actually at all. Never has been, never will be. So when you talk about a planet, you're talking about time, really. So, you know, let the fourth dimensionals do what they gonna want to do. And then work on the reorganization of the fifth and the third. The fifth dimensional is going to the fifth dimension and getting comfortable there and preparing to help out the third dimensionals where they will be reassembling in another third dimensional world, and then helping to set up religious traditions there, just like there have been on this planet. There have been great many religious traditions on this planet set up by fifth dimensionals here, coming into third dimension and teaching third dimensionals here to say, this is how you need to use your time, right use of mind, teaching them, you know, how to be successful a sojourn in the third dimension, how to get out of it as fast as possible, back to the fifth, how to do it as fast as possible. You don't want to, you know, third dimension is a nice place to visit, but you sure don't want to stay. Okay, it's a rehabilitation place. You don't want to stay in rehab forever, absolutely not. You see these people in this in third dimension who make try to make a lifestyle out of rehab, staying like let's stay, you know, just continually. They keep coming back again, again, again. More rehab, and it's like an end in itself. No. You're supposed to be have a successful rehab quickly as possible. Get it done. So that's what's up. You want to know what's up? That's what's up. This planet is entirely contaminated. It's so severely. Again, the effectiveness of third dimensional effectiveness is over here. It ended August 18th, 1999. From that point on, there's been this tremendous effort to prepare for the exodus and the reorganization, as it were, to other dwelling places. And the fourth dimension will take over this planet. And there's some the third dimensional, some will remain here, and they'll be turned into the slaves, the sudras, experiment upon to basically indentured servants and lower, that kind of thing. And they'll be re-educated, they'll be genetically altered, they'll be, you know, all that kind of stuff will take place of the third dimensionals who stay. But they won't be using their time appropriately at all, and they'll be kind of sucked in, like in the vacuum, sucking them into fourth dimensional experience, which is just a big dead end, waste of time. So, how soon is this? I don't know, but you would think very soon. Very, very soon. My situation, I to the best of my guesstimation, I would say my role in this would be to be part of a piloting team of transport vehicles. I don't know whether transporting third dimensionals as possible. Those who are capable of that may be doing just that. I may be part of a pilot team, transport pilot team, transporting third dimensionals off of this planet to another dwelling place, another third dimensional dwelling place. And as such, the pilot training, I look at A Course in Miracles like pilot training. It really is. Because you have to recognize that God is within our minds, and we cannot sin because God did not create sin. And God only created one mind, and God remains with that mind. So there is no sin in that mind. So there's nothing that can really hurt that mind at all. And this is a navigational tool, actually, to... And safety goes with me wherever I go. Safety has to go with me because I cannot be harmed. That enables one to navigate transport ships through all the fourth dimensional kind of traps and stuff that they try and prevent it from happening. So, to some extent, I've already gone through the training, but I think I need some advanced training in some regard. They talk about the rapture. The third dimensionals talk about the rapture is an event that where third dimensionals are, you know, relocated off this planet, who want to continue their discipline, their religious way of life, to so that they can realize the simple truth, and they don't want to continue on in this place where third dimensional viability effectiveness has been negated. So, of course, the idea of just being raptured up into the air atmosphere, I mean, that's just a way of talking about it. But, of course, you don't relocate that way. You know, that's a talk about lack of continuity. I mean, the idea of just shifting dimensions, you know, freak people out. So it would seem that there would be transport, that there would be, you know, some sort of physical transport or... they say they're supposed to be changed to spiritual bodies in the twinkling of an eye. Well, we'll see how it works out. But it would seem like hyperdimensional transport would be the way to go. There are ways to avoid long trips in space. They can see to be having journey long distance is going to happen very quickly actually. My hyperdimensionality and things, situations like that. So, all this stuff is kind of what many people have been talking about for quite some time now. And for those who have been preparing for these times, they will recognize the basic gist of all of this. What we're trying to do is we're trying to streamline it, clarify it, get it more and more and more clear, and get more and more basic and normalized to all this projected events that we believe is going to take place soon. So that we can just say, okay, yeah, this is the next step. This is what we're doing now. We understand the situation here. It's no longer viable. I cannot really do what I need to do here. Responsible life. The world's been too contaminated from the cradle to the grave. And I want to continue on with my proper focus and, on a third dimensional life. And so, realization, we've been told that this is now the time where we, you know, sidestep the non-viability of this planet Earth at this point, and go to a more viable place for what we need. So it's easy to talk about. It's not difficult to talk about. And there's supposed to be a big thing happening at some point. Now, it could happen quickly, because it's very possible that the takeover by the fourth dimensionals might crystallize very soon. It hasn't quite crystallized yet. That's what they're working on. Just like any type of chemical experiment, you melt stuff down, you mix, and then you want it to crystallize into its new form, as it were. So they're working on crystallizing it, which I've seen is going to involve use of some symbols and some frequencies to activate implanted, as a belief system, Trojan horse belief system viruses in people that the culture, that the fourth dimensionals have been brainwashing people and setting up these viral programs inside our belief systems of third dimensionals here, so that they can be activated. Once they're activated, then third dimensionals will be manipulated by fourth dimensionals here to carry out various scenarios. One of the scenarios will be to drastically depopulate the planet from third dimensionals. Others will be to be just indentured servants, drones, slaves, to carry out the work that the fourth dimensionals want, like the prison guards in Nazi Germany. You know, there's all these prison guards and transport people, transported the people to be eliminated. There will be various situations of the people who are under hypnotic control of the fourth dimensionals. Third dimensionals will carry out that stuff, and the third dimensionals will be either wiped out. Many will be. I see like maybe a quarter of third dimensionals completely wiped out. The ones that remain here. Dead, a quarter of them in work camps, a quarter of them in re-education camps, and then a quarter of them being lackeys and sycophants, drones for the fourth dimensionals, doing some certain work that they want done. So they'll set it up kind of like that. But overall, there'll be a quick and drastic reduction in population across the globe. And all of the third dimensionals will be in shock and will just basically submit to the fourth dimensional agenda here. Now, the ones that leave is a whole different story. The ones that are relocated to a sunnier place, that's for sure. So I don't have a timeline to give. I don't have any specific dates on this, but it is literally possible that World War III could start at any time, because the fourth dimensionals, again, can trigger. I saw the technology to trigger third dimensionals into a hypnotic state where they are easily controlled, very easily controlled, and told what to do. And literally will carry out anything that they're told to do. If they're told to start a war, they'll start a war. I mean, you get leaders of countries, generals and leaders and the command and control structure of countries under hypnotic control, third dimensionals, and they will start hostilities, and then others are told to join in. Before you know it, you have World War III. It could happen over, very rapidly. The stock market could be crashed very rapidly. As again, I've pointed out in other videos that I believe it's the work of the fourth dimensionals and their control of third dimensionals who are able to, who will crash the stock market too. So these things can happen very quickly as fourth dimensionals decide to crystallize and get their total grip upon the planet. They decide, okay, now is when we're going to move on this, and then boom, it'll happen like that. So the question is, does the rapture, as it were, the relocation, I call it, happen before the mind control event takes place, or does it happen after? Or is so how exactly does it happen? Well, we'll find out. That's for sure. We're going to find out. Whatever it is, whatever the situation is, we'll just simply deal with it as it is. But there, if you're wondering, do other people see this? A lot of people do, actually. They're just too afraid to say it. They won't talk about it. But there's a lot of people out there that beneath the surface facade of ignorance of this, they say, yeah, I know all about this. This is true. This is what's going to happen. They know it. They just, of course, they're pretending that they don't. It seems safer to pretend that they, don't know anything about this or don't understand anything about it. And that's okay. That's a defense mechanism, a way of trying to don't let the fourth dimensionals cause too many problems for you here in this world at this point. But I don't have any specifics at this point. I really don't. What I'm doing is painting the general outlines of the picture of what to prepare for and helping see the justification of all of this. 3D has a purpose. It's important. It is very important. When the purpose becomes contaminated like this, loses its viability, then relocation is necessary. It's absolutely necessary. Most three-dimensional people don't want to hang out in this hellhole that the fourth dimensionals have turned this place into. It's just an extremely spiritually irresponsible place. Getting worse all the time, with zero tolerance towards third dimensionals and their dimensionals' insistence on austerity and simplicity and non-sophistication, insistence on limiting all those distractions, assistance on marginalizing any of those who try to get away from humility, a humble lifestyle. That's all third dimensional, important, very important. And the fourth dimensionals have implemented what's called a zero tolerance policy to all of that. And really terrorizing third dimensionals here on this planet through that. With the full wave of the legal system, crushing you if you should have any objection to the fourth dimensional takeover of this planet. Because the third dimensionals know that it's very important. They don't want to go back to the fourth dimension, that dead, vast, endless dead end. And they want to succeed. And so humility and a life that reinforces, an environment that reinforces, is very important to them. Very, very important. Super important. So when that's tampered with, they don't like that. They don't like it at all. And so they will speak up angrily, say, hey, stay out of our lives. Stay out of our lives. We don't want that. We don't want you bringing in all this tinsel and glamour into this world. We don't want you primping and pimping, all the stuff that is glamorous and licentiousness and depravity and partying and you know, gambling and alcohol and blasphemous type of speech, as far as, you know, using all the swear words and taking the Lord's name in vain and all these kind of religious things. They don't like that at all. It's very, very, what it does is it tempts them to go back to their wicked ways. So they don't want to be tempted. So of course they look askance at those who bring this temptation back into their lives. And they have every right to do so, and yet they have been demonized into zero tolerance policy, that they have no right to express great disapproval of this, and even have laws that preclude it. All these laws that have precluded this have now been challenged and challenged, and are being defeated and wiped out across the board. So again, the effectiveness of 3D here is being washed away by a tsunami of fourth dimensional arrogance, is what it is. Spiritual pride, spiritual ignorance, and spiritual arrogance is hallmarks of the fourth dimensional belief system, which they say is death is necessary, but you know, we can control it. And what our purpose, the purpose of existence, is to control death and be able to produce as much, any type of quantity, as much or little as needed in any particular place. And that is our manifest destiny. That is the purpose, you know, and they insist that that's it, and are completely ignorant about truth, about God's plan of salvation, the way, and all of that. They have no idea, and they take great pride in their ignorance. So eventually all fourth dimensionals have to go through a third dimensional rehab and choose fifth dimensional. That'll have to happen. But see, they don't want that to happen. They hate that, so they want to get rid of all third dimensional planets. So this planet has been targeted for a long time, being a prime third dimensional spot. They want to get rid of it with all the religions on this planet. They want to wipe them out. So they're relentlessly demonizing them. I mean, it's funny. It's so absurd. It's funny. Now they just don't get it. They don't see any utility for it at all. You see, what in third dimension you want to feel like? Don't think that you can control death. Think that you can get free of it entirely. Don't try to control it. Get free of it. So in the third dimension, it seems like death, you know, can hunt you down and you're not in control of it. But that leaves you feeling like, wow, I can't control it, so why don't I get free of it? Let me listen to what tells me I can get free of it. So that which dies, the forms, the bodies, are not aggrandized. You're supposed to dress simple. You're supposed to look simple. You're supposed to be modest and de-emphasize beauty, human beauty, body beauty, and de-emphasize creativity, all the stuff of making things look neat and glamorous and attractive. Not supposed to focus on the attractiveness of form of things, but rather the attractiveness of truth. Of truth. That's what you're supposed to focus on in 3D. So, and again, it's not an end in itself. It's like bitter medicine that needs to be taken. Nobody's saying the 3D is such a wonderful experience. It's not. It's really a terrible experience. It's bitter medicine. But it does provide one the opportunity to find the true remedy, which then enables one to go to 5D, which is wonderful. Which then leads to the death-free realm, which is really wonderful. Which is so wonderful that all you need to do is just sit there with extreme remembrance and gratitude for reality. And it's just like a completely resonating wow. So all you do is you just resonate with this wow in the death-free realms. So fifth dimension gets one ready for the death-free realms. So by all means, we want to go to the fifth dimension. And some in this world will, definitely will. And many in the world will relocate to another third dimensional situation, where the fifth dimensionals will then come in and help and teach them. It's not necessary for fourth dimensions to take birth. Not always necessary. For instance, that like in the history of this planet, there are teachers that will show up in various places in the world and teach and then disappear, and nobody knows where they came from because they just manifested here. You know what they say? Well, they came from the Himalayas. There's some, you know, the secret caves in the Himalayas, and the masters came down from the Himalayas down to the Gangetic Plain and stuff like that. Well, then the masters, you know, can simply manifest a body in the Himalayas and then walk down into the Gangetic Plain and teach for, you know, 20, 30 years or whatever, and then walk back to the Himalayas and shift to the fifth dimension. You know, that's a piece of cake for them. But some do actually take birth in families. That's also done. And then they pass away. They go through that physical, but they don't associate with the body. They don't identify with it all. Identify with it at all. I would say those may be the more advanced ones, the ones that can come here with no identification whatsoever with the body, and teach here like that. That is very advanced. But there are plenty of stories of teachers who just simply disappeared. I think, what was it? Was it Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? Sri Chaitanya? I guess went into the temple in Puri or something, and they say he just simply vanished. Vanished. So that's, you know, fairly commonplace. There's lots of stories of these great gurus that just... I don't know what happened to Sri Shankara. You know, maybe also just vanished. Nobody knows. A lot of these gurus, nobody knows what they, you know, what happened to them. They just shifted dimensions. Piece of cake for them. Piece of cake. So this reorganization is coming up. Preparing for the reorganization, and looking forward to it, and kind of chomping at the bit. Wanting to get started on this because it's just for this world is just coming a cropper, you know, and we haven't seen anything yet. We haven't seen anything yet. It's just going to be havoc and chaos, and they want to drive the third dimensionals crazy, and so we don't want to hang around for that. We want to get the viables, you know, to a new location ASAP. Before they become so confused, they become too frightened to do anything. You know, I don't want that. And the fourth dimensionals, they hate the third dimensionals. They really do. And they want them to be wiped out because the very notion of any austerity and humility and simplicity, a lifestyle, a notion of accepting such a lifestyle is an anathema to the fourth dimensionals. Absolute anathema. Oh. A life wasted, they say. Total waste. Defective genes, defective DNA, they call it. They say we gotta pump up their DNA. Let's get some more strands together for those poor, miserable people who don't know how to enjoy life. You know, that's their judgments. They're very judgmental on the third three dimensionals. So, they really do want to drive them into the ground, and we certainly don't want that. Certainly don't want that. So, how it unfolds, we don't know. But certainly, you can get the flavor, the taste, the feel, and the sense of the context of it all here. And hopefully this video has helped with that. And we will keep you posted for sure on these most interesting times. Because who knows what tomorrow could be. Wow, big step forward, huge step forward. You know, it's even likely to be the way things are going right now, that's for sure. All right. Very great. Onward we go.